Chapter 2 is where I'm going to begin in John's Gospel. And if you are a Bible marker, I'd invite you to get out your pen and just circle some of these words because they'll start jumping out at you if you will follow along. It says in chapter 2, verse 13, "Now the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem." Now turn on over to chapter 5 and verse 1. And it says, "After this, there was a feast of the Jews." Now, it's interesting. It doesn't say which one. But if you read chapter 5, you know which one, if you know anything about the feast of the Jews. Because at the feast in chapter 5, two very special events occurred. In the Jewish culture, the older people would wear black, and they'd walk around and act as if they were getting ready to die. And also, in their culture, they would place large books on display, which were the books where a person's deeds were written down. And those two themes were what were celebrated at that feast of the Jews. One, thinking about death, and the other, thinking about being judged for how you lived your life. Well, isn't it interesting that at that feast, if you look over at verse 28, Jesus loudly told everybody in Jerusalem, "Do not marvel, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the grave will hear his," as in my, Jesus was saying, "voice." Why? Because Jesus declared at that feast, he was the one that determined when you're going to die, and he's the one that's going to judge your life. And so there's no mystery what feast that was. Chapter 6, verse 4, it says, "Now the Passover feast of the Jews was near." Again, another very interesting time. Look at chapter 7 and verse 1. "And after these things, Jesus walked in Galilee, for he didn't want to walk in Judea because the Jews sought to kill him." Verse 2. "Now the Jews' feast of tabernacles." By the way, why does John say the Jews? Well, John wrote to everyone. What's interesting is Mark wrote to the Romans, and Luke wrote to the Greeks, and Matthew wrote to the Jews. But John wrote to everyone. And so he carefully explained stuff that the masses wouldn't understand. So he said, this is one of those things the Jews did, the Feast of Tabernacles. He calls it something different later on. He calls it by another name. It has many names, but this is the final feast of the year. So look at verse 8. "You go up to this feast. I'm not yet going," Jesus tells his brothers. Verse 10. "But when his brothers had gone up," by the way, there were three times a year that all Jewish males had to show up in Jerusalem. And so Jesus' brothers were good, observant Jews, and they trotted down to the city. "His brothers had gone up. He," verse 10 continues in chapter 7, "also went up to the feast." Keep looking down at verse 14. "Now about the middle of the feast." It lasted for 2 weeks. So in the middle of the feast, "Jesus went up to the temple and taught." And it's very interesting, as you study the feast, you know what the temple looked like, you knew what they were displaying, you knew what they were doing, you knew the events, because this was very, very regulated for 3,500 years of their worship. Look at verse 37. "And on the last day of that great feast, Jesus stood and cried," and I mentioned this morning, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me." And I told you already about the procession bearing the water and how it was poured out and how Jesus culminated. Look at chapter 10 and verse 22. "Now it was the feast of dedication in Jerusalem, and it was winter. And Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch." So we know when he was there, we know where he was, and at the backdrop of this feast, Jesus gave the great message about being the good shepherd and about knowing his sheep. Keep turning over to chapter 12 and verse 1. Here's the last three successive feasts of this book. It says, actually it starts in 1155, "And the Passover of the Jews was near." And verse 1 of chapter 12, 6 days before the Passover. Now this is a countdown because Jesus was going to, as I mentioned this morning, absolutely fulfill the feasts. And so the whole book of John is built around Jesus with laser-guided precision going to target the Feast of Passover. So 6 days before the Passover, look at verse 12 of chapter 12. The next day a great multitude had come to the feast. So now we're 5 days out of this. Now look at verse 20. There were certain Greeks among those who came to worship at the feast. And one of the characteristics of the Feast of Israel were all of the proselytes from every nation around the world. And when it was time for a Jewish feast, people could be heard from the furthest corners of the Roman Empire. Under the observant Roman centurions, they would see little groups of Jews and proselytes to Judaism preparing excitedly, bringing their offerings and heading toward Jerusalem. And all the roads of Israel were just clogged with people coming. In fact, Josephus tells us the highest feast attendance of all during the first century, 3 million people crowded that city that normally only had around 300,000. That would be like Tulsa getting 7 million people. It'd be like everybody from LA coming to visit us. Wouldn't that be exciting? And you can imagine what it's like. And that's what was going on. Look at chapter 13 and verse 1. Now before the feast of the Passover. And I was sharing in the hour earlier that if you understand anything about these feasts, pictures should come to your mind. Do you know what they did 2 weeks before the Passover? Do you know what happened all over Israel? Everyone had to go out and they had to mark the graves. Because if a pilgrim who was coming from Parthia or Elam or Medes or Persia or coming from Cappadocia or Asia or Bithynia or wherever they were coming from, if they were walking across Israel in a hurry, if they walked across the back of your field where you had buried Aunt Millie or Uncle Zeke, they would get defiled and they couldn't share. So 2 weeks before the Passover, every observant Jew would take their bucket of whitewash and they would whitewash any place that they had buried a loved one. Now, does that ring any bells? Do you remember Jesus saying, you Pharisees are like what? Whitewashed sepulchers. They didn't whitewash them year-round. We knew from understanding the context of the feast that Jesus was 2 weeks before Passover in that period talking to those men because they had to whitewash those sepulchers. And he said, they're all pretty on the outside, but inside they're rotting, decaying bodies, and you're wearing your pretty white robe, but inside you're just like death. And that's the result of sin. So that's what's going on in 13:1. Keep going on over. We're going to hit a lot more. Just a second. Chapter 18, verse 28. They led Jesus to Caiaphas in the praetorium, and it was early in the morning, but they themselves did not go in the praetorium, lest they should be defiled. See, they had this big deal. No one wanted to miss the Passover, and so not only did they whitewash the tombs, but they were very careful not to do anything that would ceremonially make them unclean. And so these guys are willing to lie and murder and mock and torture, literally, Jesus Christ, but they wouldn't walk into a building and get defiled. I mean, their hands were covered with blood, their hearts were filled with evil and wickedness and hatred, but they didn't want to miss the Passover. Now, because of this verse, a lot of people say, oh, so Jesus didn't celebrate the Passover, right? Wrong. If, again, you understand the customs of the Jews, you could eat the Passover lamb twice. You ate it on the evening of the 14th, and if you were very, very spiritual, you could eat it again within 48 hours. A second time on the 15th. And these guys were the stuffed shirts of the day. They really observed the law. So they were looking forward to their second sharing of the lamb to show how spiritual they were. And so they were going to eat the second, as it were, kind of like Thanksgiving dinner. You eat the second round of it in verse 28. And so the Passover is mentioned again. Turn over to chapter 18, verse 39. It says in 39, I release someone to you at the Passover, Pilate said. Now look at 19:14. Now it was the preparation day of the Passover, about the sixth hour, and he said to the Jews, behold your king. Up in verse 31 of chapter 19 again, the preparation day, the Sabbath, it was a high day. It was a very important, it was a convergence when it was coming upon the weekend which went into the Feast of Unleavened Bread. It was the Passover. It was this convergence of the feasts. Passover, unleavened bread, and first fruits went bang, 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 Friday, Saturday, Sunday, just like that. And it was a high point in the Jewish calendar. Verse 42 mentions that again of chapter 19, the preparation day. Verse 20, to us, it's Sunday, the first day of the week. to the Jews, the first Sunday after Passover was the Feast of First Fruits. And so at this Feast of First Fruits, on the first day of the week, Mary comes to the tomb early, and the first fruits himself has already stepped out of the tomb, Jesus Christ, because Jesus fulfilled the feasts. Passover gave his life as the Lamb. Unleavened bread bore away our sins and buried them with him beneath his sacrificial death. First fruits came from the grave in triumph, in resurrection power. That's the backdrop that we're going to look at this evening. I have 84 slides for you tonight, and I'm going to show you how the feasts of faith from the Gospel by John can impact our lives. And specifically, I'm encouraging you to start thinking about how you could, through a little bit of exposure to the backdrop of the Bible, which are the feasts of God that he gave to Israel, how you could enhance your study of God's Word. Okay, here we go. Next slide. Out of the 879 verses in the Gospel by John, 660, which I just showed you, and by the way, from chapter 7, verse 1, all the way through chapter 8 is one feast, and then from 10, 1, where I showed you that next feast, all the way through the end of chapter 10, it wasn't just those verses, but all those around it. The next slide tells us at least three times each year at Passover, which they call by the Hebrew name Pesach, and Pentecost, Shavuot, and Tabernacles, Sukkot, all men were to come before God at the feast he gave to Israel. So every observant Jew would come at the springtime. You're going to see a chart of this in just a second. 7 weeks later, and then in the fall, roughly September, October, those three times, they would come to Jerusalem. Now, you didn't have to come if you lived further than 15 miles away. But if you were devout, you came no matter what. Okay, the next slide tells us their schedule. And on the inside, you see our months. On the outside, you see their months. There are two sections, fall feast, spring feast. It started out, feast number one is Passover, remembering the deliverance from the bondage of Egypt. Then, right after that, immediately following Passover, the very next day became, it just ushered into the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which was an entire process of going without any leaven, because leaven is always a picture of evil, and they were to purge out the leaven. And that culminated on, that lasted 7 days, by the way, the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And the first fruits was the first Sunday after Passover. And because of the way the moon, this is a lunar cycle. That's why, if you notice, they have more months than we do, because of the lunar cycle. And because of that lunar cycle, the Feast of Passover could be on Wednesday or Thursday or Friday. And so because of that, they made the Feast of First Fruits to be the first Sunday after Passover. Now, who designed the spring feast? God. And when did he want Christ to rise from the dead? Sunday. And so he, within the revelation of the feasts of God, planned all this. Then you see Pentecost is exactly 7 weeks. It's 7 weeks and a day, 50 days after Passover, right there, is Pentecost. Now on the 6th of the month of Sivan is when the law was given. Isn't that interesting? It's also when Enoch was born, according to the Jews. And it's also when the church was born. Now, think about this. Jesus was crucified on Passover, buried at the eve of Passover and before the sunset, and buried during the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and he rose in the Feast of First Fruits, but Jesus stayed on earth for 40 days, right up until just the week before Pentecost. Pentecost was on Sunday. Jesus stayed 40 days after his resurrection. He was in the grave for 3 days. He stayed 43 days on the earth. He left 7 days before Pentecost. Pentecost was on Sunday. Christ ascended on Sunday. Everything is Sundays. Amazing how God planned it. Here's the fall feast right here. And they come real quickly. They come, first of all, with Rosh Hashanah, the Feast of Trumpets, on the 1st and 2nd of Tishri, then the Feast of Atonement, or Yom Kippur, on the 10th day after on the 10th of Tishri, and then the tabernacles from the 15th to the 22nd. And so that whole time period, two pieces, the fall and the spring feasts. Three in the springtime, four in the fall. Next slide shows us the city, and roughly, these are the walls of Jerusalem. This is roughly what they follow in a similar manner to the city from the time of Christ. The next slide shows us the modern landmark. This part is a Muslim addition, but this part is what Herod built. This is the Herodian palace that Jesus would have walked by. This is where, in fact, Pilate, Herod was dead by the time Jesus came for his passion after his three-year ministry. But this whole area behind this crenellated wall is the palace that Herod had built for himself that Pilate took over, and that's where Jesus was brought on the eve of Passover to be tried, to be mocked, to be scourged, hauled over. He was just lightly worked over here, and then they hauled him to the main barracks, the Antonium. The next slide shows us what Herod built. Herod was a man who was very security conscious, and you can see this huge tower was part of his fortification. He was a very insecure man. But this tower, at least the bottom part of it, is exactly the same stones in what Jesus would have seen as he came in, and then, of course, that night as he was mocked and kept overnight in Caiaphas' house. The next slide shows us the inside. This is the inside of this citadel, and on the other side of this wall was the private quarters of Pilate. Remember, his wife was on the other side of this wall having bad dreams, and she ran out to her husband and said, "Honey, don't have anything to do with this man. You know, he hasn't done anything wrong," and all that. And by the way, if you count up seven different people, seven testified Jesus was blameless and guiltless. Remember, seven is the number of completion. Everybody from Pilate's wife to Pilate himself to the Roman centurion at the foot of the cross to all those witnesses that they called up, which no two of them could agree, all the way through, everybody that witnessed Jesus Christ, the thief hanging next to him, all of them said, "This man has done nothing wrong." They couldn't figure out anything, any sin he'd ever done. Next slide reminds us of the walls of which they came up to Jerusalem. Now, these walls, again, are built from Suleiman the Great from the time of Martin Luther, just to put it in your mind. These walls were built when Martin Luther was nailing his theses on the wall in 1517. So just 500 years ago, they were put up. But they were following the contours of the biblical Jerusalem. And as you can see here, people still walk around the walls. And I can just imagine, and in your mind, think about a city like this, swollen with the Passover Christ was crucified at. 2.6 million were there. Again, we know that from the temple records because you had to have 10 people per lamb sacrificed, and 256,000 sheep were slain for that Passover when Christ was crucified. Next slide reminds us of the very streets he walked. This is the Cardo, and Jesus walked on streets just like this one at the Cardo. We're talking about an advanced civilization. Don't think of Jesus walking barefooted on dirt paths. We're talking about a highly civilized city in this time. You can see the shops that were present along these streets. In fact, when the Bible says that Jesus, prior to his coming down for this ministry, ministered in what's called the Decapolis. The Decapolis was like New York City is today. It was the most advanced civilization with sewers running under the streets, running water in, running sewer out, water that was under pressure just like we have with water towers. I mean, fantastic multi-heated pools in their health clubs. I mean, they weren't behind in anything except wasteful electric power. But this is the streets through which Christ would have walked, and some of the beautiful construction. Of course, this is from later. This is from Hadrian's time. But this is from the period of Christ. Next slide shows us these spring feasts with their name. The Passover, then the and then you can see this Shag HaMatzot. The unleavened bread, matzah, you see that, the unleavened bread. And by the way, that lasted for the whole week. And so when Jesus was on the road to Emmaus, as I shared this morning, it was still unleavened bread because they were still using this unleavened bread in their meals. First fruits, ha, bikurim, and then the shavuot of Pentecost in Leviticus 23. With these feasts, God laid down the roadmap of Christ's life, his death, in his ministry. During his life, he celebrated these feasts in Jerusalem. At his death, he died at Passover. His burial, taking our sins, bearing them away, just like they took the leaven away. He was raised by the Father to attest to his atoning sacrifice on the day of first fruits, Sunday. And then on the 50th day, he sent his Spirit down after he had stayed for 40 days after his resurrection, confirming his disciples. The next slide tells us the other three feasts. The Feast of Trumpets, Rosh Hashanah, the head of the year. That's their New Year's. Now there's a religious beginning. Passover is the religious year begins. The civil year begins on Rosh Hashanah. On the 10th day after Rosh Hashanah, Yom HaKippurim, the Day of Atonement. That is the only day the Jews have to fast in the year, one day a year, and it's the most sacred day of the year. And then the Jewish Thanksgiving, the Feast of Tabernacles, or Sukkot. In the fall, God said all Israel were to celebrate the last three of the feasts. Jesus obeyed. Jesus came to Jerusalem for these feasts. And that's what John 7, 1 through 37, as we already read, is all about. The next slide reminds us about the Jewish influence that's still in the city of Jerusalem. Everywhere you go, this is the menorah, the seven-branched lampstand. When Jesus was walking amongst the lampstands of Revelation 2 and 3, this is what, when John saw him at the end of chapter 1 and fell down, and then Jesus walks and picks up the lamps and talks about them, it's not a candle. It's a oil lamp, and we'll see one in just a moment. But at the Feast of Dedication, huge golden menorahs like this one in the Jewish quarter kept the temple lit through the night. In fact, Josephus says that it was just like daytime. They had such huge menorahs that held gallons and gallons of pure olive oil, and these were huge, like giant street lights, only they were giant lamps burning oil. And not little ones like this model, but huge ones in the courtyard of the temple. And by the way, these are built according to temple specifications, because there's a whole group of Jews, not Messianic Jews, Jews, observant Jews from Israel that are not Christians and not believers that want to rebuild their temple. And they're building all this stuff and displaying it. And there's even one that's put up a cornerstone for the temple out in the city. The next slide reminds us of the first of the feast. And right here, Passover is number one. God's spring feast, Passover, start with the story of Israel's rescue from Egypt. It's a picture not only of the past, but of a future rescue. Jesus took the, and by the way, there are 15 specific elements of the Passover. And when it says in Luke that Jesus observed all the details of the feast, we can, and I'll share some of these with you tonight, we can see each of those details as we read the scriptures. But we wouldn't even see that they were details if we didn't know what was going on at Passover. And for 1,476 years, you say, where do you get that number? Well, we know that the Exodus was in 1446 BC. How do we know that? Because we are told the exact day that Solomon built the temple. And if you take that day, he says that he did that exactly, and he lists it to the day, 480 years after the children left Egypt with Moses. And if you add the date, which is in the Encyclopedia Britannica, when Solomon started the temple, add 480 years to it, we know that in 1476 BC, the Jews left Egypt behind Moses. Well, the 30-year ministry of Christ, for 1,476 years, the Jews celebrated Passover. And each time they were awaiting the Lamb of God to come and save them. And they didn't even know that. But if you can lay across the Old Testament concealed picture of Christ, if you put the New Testament revealed picture of Christ, it fills in the spaces and you see the picture. And that's what Passover did. The next slide shows us inside Jerusalem how long Passover has been celebrated. Hezekiah, as in King Hezekiah, by the way, you know, the jokes are it's written in Hezekiah, whatever. Well, that's a joke, but Hezekiah was no joke. He was a mighty man of God. But Hezekiah built this very wall right here when the Assyrians were sweeping down in their judgment, 722 BC. God sent the Assyrians to wipe out the northern kingdom because of their apostasy their idol worship. And in 722 BC, the northern kingdoms, the 10 tribes, were carried away into captivity, and all the pagans were intermarried, and that's where the Samaritans came from. But the Assyrians came down and brought their crack troops, 185,000 of them, to camp on the other side of this wall. So right where this is, on this side of the wall, Hezekiah was standing up here on this broad wall, looking down at 185,000 of the finest warriors in the world. So he got a little alarmed, and he runs inside, and it says he spreads out his prayer to the Lord in the temple. And Isaiah, and you can read all this in Isaiah, Isaiah represents the Lord to Hezekiah and says, don't fear, God's going to take over. He said, God has seen what that wicked king has mocked the name of God, so that all the world may know there really is a God. He said, watch what's going to happen. And that night, on this side of that wall, here the Jews are all cowering and a little frightened, and here's Hezekiah standing up on the wall looking down, and he goes to the temple and prays. The next morning, he comes back and looks over that wall, and all he could see was about 90 acres of dead bodies laying in rows. The angel of the Lord had killed 185,000 Assyrian troops in their sleep. Got them all. This wall is underneath the city of Jerusalem. In fact, you can see right there is the current street level. And they've excavated this, and Hezekiah put it up so hastily. If you look down here in these remnants, you'll find he actually just put it right across people's houses. I mean, there's a whole house underneath that wall. I mean, they didn't stop for anything. They built that wall. But they didn't need that wall because God protected them. The next slide shows you kind of where we are. Because to the Egyptians, the killing of a lamb was a desecration of their religion. But the Passover sacrifice, when Moses instituted it, was a direct attack and challenge to their gods. And people who believe that Jesus is the promised Messiah have embraced the spiritual significance of the holidays of God. Why? Because Jesus himself took Passover. He exactly followed and fulfilled the details of the Feast of Passover and took it a step beyond. And every time we celebrate the Lord's Supper right here, we are celebrating something that's built on the platform of the Passover. The next slide tells us some of the details. Jesus claimed that he had come to fulfill the meaning of the Passover sacrifice. And each time we share the cup of communion, we share the Passover cup of the new covenant. Jesus Christ, as Paul said, has become our Passover. The Jews, they were just thinking about getting free from the Egyptians. Jesus says, I've got a bigger thing for you. You need to be free from death. And I offer myself. And so that cup that Jesus took, one of the four cups, he transformed the Passover into the Lord's Supper. By the way, I mentioned this morning about the middle piece of pierced unleavened bread hidden in the cloth. See the symbolism? The middle piece, the second of the three pieces, the middle piece being signifying the second person, the Son of God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Even within the Jewish ongoing festival today of unbelieving Jews is the message of the deity of Christ. The next slide shows us the way that they sit and the triclinium set up, and this is something that the pilgrims that go over to Israel, this is called the Seder at the Biblical Gardens, and there's a man who has spent his life in Israel helping people to reenact a Passover Seder, and he goes through and explains it all, and you get to eat like the disciples, and they explain it all to you. But Jesus ate his meals very much like this biblical Seder, and we can tell there are little clues within the Gospels. When John is whispered to by Peter, and he leaned back and talked to Christ. We can almost tell where everybody was sitting at the Last Supper. The next slide shows us something which I think is fascinating. Remember I told you that Jerusalem roughly follows the same borders and the walls. It's been changed over the years, but a lot of it is configured the same. Well, when the Roman army came and conquered Jerusalem that final time in AD 70, the climactic time, when 1 million Jews were slaughtered, remember, it was swollen for the feast. And the Romans kept them inside. and people were starving to death, and every day bodies were thrown over the walls because there's no place to bury them. It was really a horrible thing, but the climactic time. And by the way, the Babylonians destroyed Jerusalem on exactly the same day that the Romans destroyed Jerusalem. Isn't that kind of ominous? Very same day. It's a double whammy in their history. But when they torched the city, most of the finer homes had wooden roofs. And so what happened is they started burning and fell inward and, of course, smothered and burned alive and killed the people, and everything collapsed down. And when the archaeologists got there, after the Jews conquered back the old city in 67, they started excavating. And right here, you can see this is a table and pots and everything inside of a home that hasn't been touched for 1,930 years. Now, the next slide will show you. This is the table set. And right there is a Roman spear. So obviously there was some fighting going on as it was burning, and the people were trying to get out, and they were killing them. They found skeletons around. But isn't it interesting to think that that table and the pots, the amphora, and all their serving containers, and their, you know, there's a, see, coffee is universal. See that coffee cup right there? They were drinking Barnes & Noble back then. But all that is still just like it was from the time of Christ. Now, the next slide shows a kitchen. This is a house kitchen, and we don't even have to guess about it. This is exactly the kind of utensils that would have been used for preparing and making and grinding and serving and baking bread and doing all that. This was just left because the people died, the building burned and collapsed in, and the Romans weren't about to excavate those houses and look for anything. They just let it lie. And inside of this is just a wealth. And by the way, next door to this place, this is called the Burnt House, and it's just a small area, but next door to this are the homes of the Sadducees. And you can even see their dishes and the beautiful mosaic floors. In fact, when Jesus said that foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man doesn't have a place to lay his head, you know what he was talking about? He was talking about these critters, these Sadducees. Many of them had 6,000 square foot homes. Even today, that's a healthy sized house. I mean, few people in America live in a 6,000 square foot house. Those religious leaders did. They had indoor swimming pools. Indoor swimming pools. I mean, Tulsa, we have a lot of outdoor ones. They had indoor swimming pools inside the old city of Jerusalem. Okay, the next slide tells us about the Seder. We're talking about the Passover, showing you the kitchen it was prepared in. Jesus followed all the details of a typical Passover. Four cups are shared, each with its own significant picture in the ritual. Now, this is the Jewish celebration. Look how Jesus grabs on each one of these. The first cup is called the cup of sanctification, which sets the feast apart from any commonplace meal. Jesus said, "But of God am I made to you your sanctification." That's why he was the fulfillment of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. He bears away our sin. He sanctifies us. He makes us holy. That's why we call one another saints. Secondly, in the Passover, the second cup is the cup of plagues, remembering the calamities visited upon the Egyptians. Jesus said, "I took your sin upon myself," as Paul put it in 2 Corinthians 5:21, "For he who knew no sin became sin for us." He took our plagues. Hymn writer has captured this. "He took my sin and my sorrows. He made them his very own. He bore my burden to Calvary, suffered and died alone." The third cup is called the cup of redemption, recognizing and memorializing the Hebrews' release from captivity. Remember the Roman Empire and the whole idea of slaves and slave markets, and if your friend or relative was captured or did something wrong or didn't have enough money to pay their debts, they were put into slavery. So what could you do? You could go and redeem them. Now, that's another interesting thing about Passover. Not only did they whitewash all the tombs so nobody walked over them, Passover was also when slaves who wanted to serve their masters forever would come and have their ears pierced through with an awl at the doorpost of the house. That all occurred. I mean, there's so many things that occurred, and that's when Jesus said, "I am giving the cup of redemption. I am offering myself as to purchase you to be your redemption, in whom you have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins." And finally, the fourth cup is called the cup of praise, during which the family recites these praise psalms, Psalm 113 to 18. And that's why Jesus, they sang a hymn and they went out. That's what they were doing. And so Jesus took that third cup and transformed this 1,476-year Passover deal into the Lord's Supper. Oh, we got to go a little faster. Okay, let's talk a little faster. Next slide. Here we are at the Feast of Passover. It would have been crowded, and here is by the Damascus Gate. Jesus would have walked down an area not too dissimilar to this, out the Damascus Gate and to the cross. The next slide shows us just what the Roman Gate looked like. Now, I remind you that Jerusalem today in places is 50 feet above the level of the time of Christ. Other places, not so much rubble. But Jerusalem is the most destroyed and rebuilt city in the world. Over 30 times it's been destroyed and rebuilt, destroyed and rebuilt. This gate is the Roman Gate, Damascus Gate. Now, this is underground, and that's a little place you pay to go in and see all the stuff in there. Way up here is street level now. It's 20 feet below ground. But when they excavated down the modern Damascus Gate, built the time of Martin Luther, 1517, they began digging down, and they found the Hadrian. That's the early 2nd century gate, which is built over the top, basically, of what the time of Christ gate system would have been. Because, you know, they weren't real creative. If it was a good gate for 500 years ago, why move it? You know, they just put another one above it. And that's how we have kind of marked through these Roman-era stones. The next slide shows us that exactly at the Feast of Passover, Jesus was offered as the Lamb of God, and he wasn't offered on a green hill far away. That's a hymn. The Bible doesn't say that. He was offered close to the ground on a cross where people could spit on him. Have you ever seen those pictures of that distant hill and everybody standing, you know, a long ways away? I mean, Jesus was at ground level. Their feet were just off the ground. They were at almost eyeball level because the Romans wanted to maximize the impact. They wanted you to be able to read the sign that everyone had a sign, not just Jesus. Everybody had a sign. The sign told what their crime was, and Jesus' crime was he was the King of the Jews. And so Jesus, exactly at the Feast of Passover, was offered as the Lamb of God. Next slide shows us a tomb from the first century, which just happens to be under the Roman Catholic Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And through most of the archaeological excavations, it is very possible that that church sits over an area that was outside the walls that very likely could have been involved in the crucifixion of Christ. The only reason we don't really like to go there is there's so much smoke in the air and so many candles burning and so many people shaking their incense that you really don't get the message. But this is underneath the whole church. This is a first century AD tomb that had a rolling stone that's underneath the ground that's all hidden by this church. The next slide reminds us of the second of the feast. Remember, the second and third all come together, but Passover, then unleavened bread starts immediately when Passover's over. But on the Sunday, it says here, speak to the children of Israel and tell them that you shall bring the first fruits of your harvest to be accepted on your behalf. On the day after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. And actually, it says on the first day, when the legislation is detailed, it says on the first day of the week after the Passover. That's how we know it's on Sunday. And so there we are at first fruits, which is the third of the four spring feasts. The next slide tells us about unleavened bread, which is also synonymous with this time. It's a 7-day long period. And it says on the 15th day of the same month is the Feast of Unleavened Bread to the Lord. 7 days eat unleavened bread, and there's some unleavened bread. Here it is, going into this period. Passover launches this period of time, and the Feast of Unleavened Bread exactly comes at sundown on Passover and goes for 7 days. But on the Sunday that falls right after Passover is the Feast of First Fruits. The next slide tells us about we have left our own Egypt, carrying our bread with us, and are not merely with us, but in us, the very bread of life. See, we, as Christians, portray this. The Feast of Unleavened Bread speaks of our need for a break from the bondage of our old way of life. It is the unleavened bread of the Passover is fulfilled by God's Messiah. It means that we are not left to live a sinless life in our own strength. There are indications that the God of the Bible wants us to see Jesus as our source of sinless bread. Bethlehem, the place of Jesus' birth, is rendered in Hebrew as Bet Lechem, meaning the house of bread, keeping in mind this picture of Messiah as our matzah. Listen to what Jesus said in the Gospel of John. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him, as the Father sent me to, and I live because of the Father. So he who feeds on me will live because of me. And that means that Jesus is our source of the sinless bread that we need. You say, what is that? Well, the Lord's Supper doesn't bring us salvation. It reminds us that only those who are partaking personally of Christ, He is our life. He is the bread of our life. He sustains our life. Not through eating the picture of Him, but through salvation and through the spiritual nourishment He offers. The next slide reminds us this act of leaving Egypt with unleavened bread has led to one of the most colorful traditions of the Passover season. And when you understand Jewish custom, Christianity becomes so much more vivid. Floors are swept all over Israel. Pots are boiled. Cupboards are emptied, all in the effort to remove any trace of leaven. And by the way, good Jewish mamas stick leaven all over the place so kids can find it, so they can get the picture of rooting it out. And they actually go for a leaven search. And as I told you this morning, they burn it in the streets. Even today, they have little fire pots where they take this stuff out. Then, just before Passover, bonfires are lit in empty lots and fields, as I said. Unleavened bread speaks of our readiness. Now, this is the application for us. To put away from us the evil inclination that lives within all of us. In other words, we're supposed to, that's why it says, before you partake of the Lord's Supper, you're supposed to examine yourself. See, that's written with the backdrop of this feast of unleavened bread and this looking for any leaven of sin in the life. Before you partake of the Lord's Supper, you're supposed to examine yourself. God did not deliver His people from Egypt just for them to be free, but that they'd be free from the bondage of sin. The Apostle Paul, a Jewish scholar in his own right, may have been alluding to this very Feast of Unleavened Bread when he wrote in 1 Corinthians 5, verses 7 and 8, "Purge out the old leaven." That's the Feast of Unleavened Bread. "That you may be a new lump, since truly you are unleavened. For indeed Christ our Passover." I mean, that's the New Testament. And that's even beyond the Gospels. You know, there are these Acts 9 dispensationalists that says the New Testament doesn't even start until Paul in Acts 9. This is significantly beyond Acts 9. And he's using all Jewish metaphors. And if you don't understand the Feast of Unleavened Bread and Passover, you don't even know what he's talking about. You just guess. And that's why it's so important. Not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. That's Paul's building on the Jewish custom. The next slide reminds us that on Pentecost, that's the fourth feast, all the spring feasts culminated in the new covenant era, which the Spirit of God would begin establishing a new kingdom on earth on Pentecost. The first fruits of the resurrection was followed by Pentecost with the first fruits of the church. An important fact about Shavuot is that one of these three pilgrim feasts, when all Israelite men were required by law to come to Jerusalem and bring their offerings, on this day, as Acts tells us, there would have been Hebrews from all over the known world. All over. From the furthest reaches of the empire. This was not merely some utopian teaching and a thing to humanly strive for, as if a man could attain to such merits. It was a promise of the Most High. God says, "My Spirit will come and dwell in you," and that's the new covenant. A new heart I'll give you, a new spirit I'll give you. Next slide. If you count 50 days, it says in Leviticus 23, after the seventh Sabbath, it shall be a statute forever. And that's where we are in the fourth feast right here. So the spring feast right here, we've seen the four of them. The next slide. Is it merely a coincidence that God appointed these springtime festivals? And John's Gospel said that Jesus tabernacled among us, and the climax of His time on earth was the crucifixion. The battle was waged in the events of the Passover. I showed you all the way through those last chapters of John. Passover, Passover, Passover. 5 days, 6 days out. And finally the day. As He became both the bread and the wine and the lamb of the sacrifice, that death might pass over both the Jewish believers and all mankind who accepted Him. By faith today, 3 days and nights passed until the victory was declared. At first fruits, Jesus, the slain lamb, became the Savior, the first fruit of our resurrection, glorified, dedicated, conquering the power of sin and death forevermore. And with great anticipation, we count the days from Passover to Pentecost and the birth of the church. You know, it's so interesting. The Roman Catholic Church celebrates a lot of feasts. Wouldn't it be something if the feasts that Christians celebrated were actually in the Bible? Instead of celebrating pagan feasts like Lent, which has nothing to do with God, it has everything to do with paganism. If anybody's been doing celebrating, they should celebrate the stuff that's written in the Bible. Is it merely a coincidence, I'm right there, that these New Testament events correspond so perfectly to the picture and lessons presented to us in the feast days? And does God have pictures for us of the final harvest represented in those three fall festivals? Okay, in the next slide. God's fall feasts are Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and Sukkot. This series of holidays has significance reaching far beyond the nation and the culture of Israel. And this is a picture of an observant Jew blowing his ram's horn. I bought this in 1987. I never knew what it was for till 3 weeks ago. Here we go. Now, this is not a cow's horn, because that reminded them of the golden calf. This is a ram's horn, which harkens back to Isaac on the altar and in the thicket. What was caught in the thicket? A ram. And so they blow the horn to remind them not of the golden calf, but of the sacrifice of the ram. Okay, the next slide. It was at Rosh Hashanah, when the trumpet was blown, that Jesus went to the southern pool of Bethesda in John chapter 5. That is the feast that's not identified by John. It's just a feast of the Jews. Why did he come there? Because the trumpet was blown. With the trumpet, they thought of the last trump, they thought of the judgment, and they thought of their death. And so Jesus, while all of them were walking around in black, carrying big books like the judgment books, Jesus shows up and says, don't worry about that. Everybody in the grave is going to hear my voice, and they're going to come forth. And they're going to be either going to the judgment of life or the judgment of death, depending on what they did with me. Boy, they didn't like him. Next slide. This is the Byzantine-era church that's in Crusader churches built over the middle of the pools of Bethesda. Why did Jesus go there? Because at Rosh Hashanah, it's the new beginning. And he picked a man who for 38 years had laid there, wasted, by the pools of Bethesda. And everybody was so selfish, nobody helped him into the pool to get healed. And so one day Jesus came up and he says, do you want to be healed? And the guy looked up and said, what are you, another joker teasing me? And Jesus said, no, why don't you stand up? And the guy walked. And where did he go? He ran into the temple carrying his bed and got Jesus in trouble again because he did it on the Sabbath. Okay, the next slide. During the feast, Jesus probably walked by a cotton market, not too much unlike this one. Next slide. Tractors now go through those alleys. The people look just like Moses and Abraham. And it's amazing how crowded it gets over there. It's very exciting. The next slide shows how narrow these old city streets are. Many of them are built around actual first century masonry, and they built their house around it. And some people, you know, in their dining room have a 2,000-year-old stone that they lean against when they eat. It's very interesting. Next slide. Jesus walked through the old city Jerusalem streets like this at least 3 times every year because he observed the feast. Next slide. Today, you know, they're lined with these little bumps so the tractors can drive up them, but they're not very much different than the time of Christ. The next slide. The holidays of God, at least 3 times a year, at Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles, all men were to come before God. Why? God says, I want you to stop your life. I want you to pay attention to me. And I want you to come into my presence. And I want you to present yourself to me. I want you to come acknowledging you need redemption. I want you to come acknowledging that all that you have comes from me. As the Feast of the Weeks comes along, of all the great summer harvest, and then I want you to come with true thanksgiving, the highest, most joyous time of the year, the Feast of Tabernacles. And I don't want you to lightly thank me. I want you to thank me for the entire period of time and worship me who gives you all things. Last slide, or almost last, from the Gospel by John 7:1 to 10:39, Jesus is at the 2-week-long Feast of Tabernacles, or Sukkot. In the fall, the blowing of the shofar at Rosh Hashanah starts the final 3 feasts, and they go from the first of the month through the 22nd. And I think that's the last one. Do we have one more? Oh, the Feast of Sukkot. Oh, I bet there's a lot more. Let's go through them fast. This is what they do today. Let's finish these. Next slide. At Christ's final Passover, when he talked about the 10 virgins and their lamps, these oil lamps were found in the first century level of Jerusalem. That's what the women didn't trim and didn't have their oil for. Next slide is the end. Ah, we made it. Let's bow together. Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, our Passover. Thank you for being our unleavened bread, bearing away our sins, for being the first fruits, our firstborn from the dead, that we might know that you are the resurrection and the life, so we need never fear death. Thank you for being the great Pentecost, sending your Spirit to dwell within us so that we might live in the power of God, your life here on earth. Thank you that we await the trumpet sound, because at the trumpet, your plan for Israel will commence again, and your church will be brought into your presence. Come quickly, Lord Jesus. But I pray that none of us would be ashamed before you at your coming. On that day of atonement, when you finally make all of Israel look on you whom they have pierced, and the end of the tribulation is ignited by your stepping foot back on the Mount of Olives and splitting it. And then you usher in the most glorious time for Israel, the true fulfillment of the Feast of Tabernacles, the millennium, when you live and reign and rule on this earth for 1,000 years. Our hearts say with the Apostle John, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. I pray that our hearts will be drawn to your word and that we would not ignore to our own neglect and loss your feasts, O God. But may we see you, O Christ, fulfilling all 7 of them. In your precious name we pray. Amen.